Daniel Ripes is corporate finance manager and also works in business development at PEAT International. You know, Daniel, a bunch of audience members sent me emails saying I need to be talking about plasma gasification. And I looked it up and it does exist, which was step one in figuring out whether I want to talk about it. And I don't really understand everything about it, so I'm hoping you can tell me a little bit. My understanding is this is potentially a new way to turn waste into energy, but that's kind of as far as I got. I mean, how does it work?
Right. So first off, it's nice to know that your viewers and listeners are trying to stay up on some of the latest trends in this industry. Gasification in itself is a process that converts organic or let's say fossil-based material into mainly carbon monoxide and hydrogen and a little carbon dioxide. And they do that by superheating the material inside of a reactor, usually somewhere in the neighborhood of at least a minimum of about 700 degrees Celsius, usually much more above that, 12 to 1500 degrees Celsius. And what you're getting out of that is a alternative to natural gas called syngas. And their control, and by their way that they're creating that is by controlling the chemistry, specifically the oxygen and or steam content that would be within that reactor itself. And that syngas has an energy value to it. Depending on the feedstock, let's say it could be worth about a quarter to a third of what natural gas would be. And what you can use that for is in a combustion engine or a gas engine and generate electricity from it. You can use it as a precursor for liquid fuels, or you can even use it, I've read that you can use it as a precursor also for fuel cells.
So basically you're putting in trash that could be just trash from a landfill. Does it need to be sorted? I mean, presumably if people throw out, for example, like a fluorescent bulb that has some mercury in it, you wouldn't necessarily want to gasify that, right? I mean, what kind of sorting is necessary before you can get the process started?
Right. Well, if your sole goal is obviously to generate electricity, then obviously what you want to do is you want to try to create as homogeneous, if you will, of a feedstock. Obviously, removing items that are not going to gasify or are inorganic, such as your examples of the bulb, or let's say batteries for an example, things that are not going to derive energy. You're not going to be able to derive energy from them. And they're only going to complicate the reactions that are going on inside.
So what are the byproducts of this? I mean, the people that were emailing me were saying this is great because you're turning trash into energy and you use the energy for electricity or for whatever you would use it, and that's great. But that doesn't sound like a closed system to me, right? I mean, the syngas that you're producing is then burned, but what's the byproduct of burning that syngas?
Well, I've read a number of different studies and there have been a number of different studies of utilizing syngas in gas engines or boiler systems, and what we've seen is that that the exhaust from those engines or boilers tend to be cleaner than what would be if you are burning natural gas in that environment. So what you would be seeing in that regard is a lower emissions point than what's traditionally seen from a perspective of burning natural gas.
Do you know if it is toxic though? I mean, whatever byproduct there is left, even if it's less, is it, what's the qualitatively, what is it?
Well, in terms of what's coming out of the stack from a gas engine.
Exactly.
It'd be what you traditionally would see in terms of the composition of gases. Largely it's gonna be carbon dioxide and water vapor. That's largely exhaust associated from that type of an engine.
What's the potential here moving forward for actually starting to use this technology? I mean, I've read that the technology itself has been kind of known about and around for 50 years, but it's never really translated into mainstream usage. Is it true that there is going to be a plant coming online in the next year? That's what one person said. I found some evidence of that. How close are we to using this?
Well, without getting overly complicated, I think you kind of can divide the application of it into two categories, if you will. And one category is utilizing plasma gasification, or sometimes people will refer to it as plasma assisted gasification. And that's, I think, kind of what you have been focusing on, at least with some of the research, has been utilizing waste energy on a large scale, treating MSW, municipal solid waste. And what's required for that, for those systems to really work economically, is a large scale gasification system and quantities of feedstock, you know, ranging to 200 to 300 tons per day. And one of the reasons why you don't see a number of those systems around, as you pointed out, the technology has been in development for quite some time now, is that there's an educational curve, obviously, associated with you know, with any environmental permit associated with this technology.
We've been speaking with Daniel Reifs, corporate finance manager, also works in business development at PEAT International Incorporated. Great to talk to you, Daniel, and I'm glad that our audience has broached this topic, because certainly I think a lot of people are not familiar with this technology. So great to talk to you today.
My pleasure as well. Thank you so much for the opportunity.